So the new version, Lightroom Classic 2024, is released right now. Check out the new features. So here's a feature a lot of people are going to love, and it's lens blur. So here is the lens blur. Notice it's an early access, which means that it's not quite ready for production, but it's ready for you to play around with and try it out. So we're going to choose apply. And what it's doing is it's using AI or Adobe Sensei to figure out where the foreground is and the background and build a depth map. So notice how it starts to blur the background. If we hide that and then show it, we can blur it all the way. Let's blur it all the way up. And currently it's a little bit slow, so don't expect great performance at the moment. It's done a pretty good job of masking out the helicopter and some of the foreground areas. Now we can change the focal range. The focal range is literally where is the camera focusing. Right now it's in the middle. And see at the bottom here, you can see these little depths that it's visualizing. If I drag this across to the front, notice it's focusing on the front now. We can shift this focus to the back. So now it's focusing on the back and the foreground is blurry. We can also grab this little tool here and we can click on the area that we would want to put in focus. And of course, if there's a person in there, we can grab that there and set that automatically. All right, so there's other things that we can do. We can make the depth of field shallower or we can make it wider. Now depth of field is the area that can be in focus at the same time. So if you have a very shallow depth of field, that's something like a 1.2 or a 1.4, and if we pull these closer together, it's going to give us a very shallow depth of field here. Catch up. So notice that the front of the helicopter is in focus but not the back. And of course, you know, we can drag this to different ranges. Now let's increase the depth of field. So this would be the equivalent of, you know, maybe shooting at an f5.6 or something right now. If you pull it further out, you know, you go up to an f11, f22. But notice now, so we've got more of the area is sharper and less of it is out of focus. And of course, we can change the focusing distance. So it's heading more towards the foreground. Now, most of the time, you're probably not going to have the blur all the way at 100. You might bring it back to a smaller amount like here. And you can see that's looking pretty convincing. Now there's other things we can do. We can visualize the depth. If we turn this on, it's going to give us an overlay and it shows us, you know, these yellow areas are more in the foreground. And of course we're going into the dark blues and blacks are further into the background. And you can see on here, see the little histogram kind of looking thing there? That will help us with that too. And if you're getting any value out of this video, hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. So here's a shot I did in New York City that said apply. Okay, we've got a large amount of blur there. Let's hit the visualize, because I see some weird stuff going on with that smoke, and I can see what's happening there. It thinks the smoke is part of the sky, where it isn't. See, we choose focus, because this is a closer area, and just kind of paint over here a little bit, and I'm just kind of getting those clouds to just fit in. If I take the visualize off, see how that just blends in much more realistically now, and we don't have that weird kind of an effect. All right, so what we want to do is we want to make sure we turn on blur, because we want to blur some of this building. So we're going to put that, increase the amount, and then we're just going to paint down there. Okay, that amount is a little high. Let's bring it back. And notice how I can adjust it in real time, which is very nice. That way we can make it match. And I want to paint a little bit in the bottom there too. So you can see how you can use this to refine what you want to blur and what you want to keep in focus. Let's go in down there, that should be blurring. And then if I wanted to do something a little bit closer, I would hit the plus, I would apply a different one and do it that way. All right, so what I want to show you here though is the bokeh. The bokeh is the areas of light, like how the light reacts when it goes out of focus. If I hide this for a second, you can see those are the light areas. And then this is the bokeh. I'm going to boost the bokeh to make it really strong so you can see it very easily. And we get different shapes. So here's just the standard one. And then we're going to grab the second one here. And this is going to give us kind of like a halo effect. See how we get this circle within the circle. Or if you want to go to a 5-blade aperture, this is more like a classic or a vintage camera. And see how we get that different shape. Instead of the round bokeh, we start to get the pentagon shape. And then we've got this one here, which is kind of a little bit odd. But, you know, if you like that kind of shape, or of course we can go to that one. There's different options here. And if we can look at this before and after. So this kind of demonstrates how that feature works. The next one we want to look at is point color, where we can target specific colors and make adjustments to them. So you'll see that this is under the mixer. So usually you'll see a mixer here, and the point color is what we're going to be using. So we're going to use the eyedropper to sample a color. So why don't we start with the hackles here on this rooster? So I'm looking at that area. I'm selecting the bright orange or the lighter orange area. And notice that that is selected. It shows it there. So now we have three dimensions we can adjust: hue, saturation, and luminance. So hue will change the color itself. So we want to make it more red, or we want to make it more yellow, we could do that. Saturation is the amount of color. Notice how it's also affecting the sand. We'll look at that in a moment. And then the luminance will be either darkening or lightening under that area. Okay, so let's hit visualize range, and this shows us the area so we can see color here. It looks like it's got the hackles, but it's also picking up some of the sand. We can adjust the range. By the way, you can twirl it open here, and we can see we can adjust it by hue, saturation, or luminance. So if we slide this up, we're going to take it out of the sand, because the sand, of course, is a little bit brighter. So now we're hitting that area, and we could also just adjust the range itself. All right, so notice we're not really affecting the sand, we're just affecting the hackles now. So we could increase the saturation. We could maybe lighten those up a little bit. All right, let's take the visualize range off. Now, what if we wanted to hit maybe the sand separately? Well, the nice thing about this is we can apply it to more than one. See that little swatch tells us, hey, this is a color we've adjusted. I can grab the eyedropper once more and I can click here in the sand. Notice we get a second color. And what I can do with this one is I'm going to make it a little lighter. I'm going to hit the luminance. Maybe pull the saturation down just a little bit. All right, so we're not being so distracted by the sand anymore. And why don't we hit those greens while we're at it? So let's grab this. Tap there on the greens. And by the way, you can move the sliders or you can move in here. Going from the left to right is going to change the hue or the color. Notice how the hue shift. Now dragging up or down is going to affect the saturation. So we're going to give it more saturation. And then when we're looking for the luminance or brightness, we can adjust it here. Let's go a little brighter in those greens. So if we look at overall, this is what it was before. And there we are after. So the next one we want to look at is HDR preview. To find the settings for this, you want to be in the develop module, and you're going to go up to the top of the basic, and we're going to turn on HDR. Now, you have to have an HDR monitor in order for this to work. So you need to go to your monitor settings if your monitor supports HDR and turn on HDR, or high dynamic range. And if I turn that off, there's the regular. Notice these bright areas are losing detail. But when I turn on HDR, we start to see more detail through here and look at the reflections in the water. And the reason for that is the dynamic range of what the camera is able to capture. HDR is when you extend the dynamic range beyond what you can fit on the sensor of your camera. So this is the spectrum of light from white light to black darkness. The dynamic range is how much of this can this sensor capture at one time. Maybe your sensor can capture this much, which is why sometimes you'll see people will overexpose a shot because they want to capture the detail in the shadows, or they'll underexpose because they want to capture the detail in the highlights, which is more common. Things like sunsets, instead of seeing a blown out sky, you want to capture that beautiful ball of light coming down. So what we do is we stack it by taking multiple photos, merge them together. And that's what an HDR is. So a standard dynamic range can't capture as much detail in the highlights and shadows simultaneously. So look at this area over there. If I go back to take the HDR off, see how those colors are just kind of gone and it's flat. See how it's blowing out there, no detail. HDR shows more detail on an HDR monitor. Now, if you look up on the histogram, this shows us this little bar here. To the left is SDR, or standard dynamic range. This is what most monitors can handle. Then on the other side, this is my monitor. See how my monitor has a little bit more into the HDR space. Everything that is highlighted here from the left of my cursor is visible on this display. So right now I'm seeing more colors and details in the highlights and shadows than I would normally see on a standard monitor. And we can visualize this HDR if we turn it on, and as we go into these other ranges, that detail's there, we just can't see it. So everything over here can be seen. Now an SDR monitor obviously can't see all of this, so we can click preview for an SDR monitor, and this is where we tone map. So if I want to take those areas and blow them out a little bit here to imply that they really are brighter, then we can adjust it in such a way. Then when we turn this off, there's our HDR, there's our standard dynamic range. So you can start to match it a little bit better. Now the other thing you can do is when you export these, you want to take something that supports HDR, such as a JPEG XL. So we can choose a bigger space, like maybe a display P3 is probably pretty good for this. And if we hit HDR output, this is going to output this photograph in HDR. So that means if you have a monitor that supports HDR, you're able to view it in pure HDR. And if you don't have an HDR monitor, you're going to see it kind of similar to what we had the preview for the SDR display. Other changes are the ability to filter presets. So let's do black and white. So I just type that and we can see these sets now are in black and white. Or if you want black and white punch, notice that you can filter by these different names. Another thing, if you create snapshots, let's just make this cooler just for a second. We're going to create that snapshot. And let's make it warmer. Create that snapshot. And now when you roll over, you can see a preview of what those different snapshots look like. So drop a comment underneath and let me know what is your favorite new feature and what feature would you like to see me go more in depth. And if you want to learn about the new features in Photoshop, check out my other video here. If you're new to the cafe, hit the subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. Until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.